Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Today's a very special day for the Department of Surgery and for the Division of Trauma. I've said this before when I introduced previous speakers. It's always fun to introduce somebody that you've known for a long time, that you have a long-standing friendship with. Today is no different. Our speaker today is Dr. L.G. Britt. Before I formally introduce Dr. Britt, I would like to acknowledge the presence of Dr. Brent Eastman, past president of the American College of Surgeons here. It's when important people come to give grand rounds, all the important people in town show up, you know. Dr. Britt went to the University of Virginia for his undergrad education, then to Harvard Medical School and the School of Public Health, did his general surgery residency at WashU and University of Illinois Cook County Hospital, and his trauma critical care fellowship at Shock Trauma, University of Maryland. In 1986, he received his first appointment as assistant professor at Eastern Virginia Medical School, and he has been there since. In 1994, he became professor and chair of the Department of Surgery. He's the Henry Ford Professor and Edward J. Brickhouse Chair of the Department of Surgery at Eastern Virginia Medical School. There are many, many impressive things about LG's career, and I will highlight just a few to put in perspective to the young folks in the audience that it is possible to get to the top. You just need to work very hard. So I'll talk to you about LD the academician. 21 editorial boards, 203 visiting professorships. He's an honorary member of the Royal College of Surgeons of England, Edinburgh, West Africa, Ireland, South Africa, Glasgow, French Academy of Surgery, and most recently, he was inducted as a member of the National Academy of Medicine, the highest honor, I'm sure, of his career. He's the editor of 3 textbooks, 57 book chapters, 225 published research manuscripts, and thousands of lectures and presentations. Well, this is great, but you know what characterizes LD's career, in my opinion, and we've been friends for 2 decades now, and I've been observing what he has done, is the fact that he is a servant leader, and he's a leader to our profession. He's been the past president of the American College of Surgeons, of the American Association for the Surgery of Trauma, American Surgical Association, Society of Black Academic Surgeons, Halsted Society, Southern Surgical Association, Southeastern Surgical Congress, Society of Surgical Chairs. Quite impressive. He's been the director, chairman, or on the executive board of the National Board of Medical Examiners, the American Board of Surgery, the RRC for Surgery, the Joint Commission, the Association for Surgical Education, and Association of Program Directors in Surgery. I will not even comment on the long list of positions he has held at his own university, at Harvard, and at the University of Virginia. But I want to mention 2 things that caught my eyes when I was looking at his CV. One is the presidential appointment given to L.G. Britt by George W. Bush as a member of the Board of Regents of Uniformed Services University of Health Sciences. And the second is his appointment to the National Academy of Medicine that I already mentioned just at the end of 2016. The list of awards that Dr. Britt received is several pages long, but it's important to mention that L.G. has received the Martin Luther King Jr. Community Leaders Award and Community Service Award multiple times, in addition to the Role Model of the Year 100 Black Men in America Award in 2012. LG is a phenomenal surgeon, a great teacher, and a fantastic mentor and friend. I personally have benefited tremendously from his mentorship and friendship over the last 20 years. He has been an inspiration to many of us in academic surgery. I consider L.G. Britt one of the 3 most influential academic surgeons in the United States today. And he will speak today to us about the ongoing challenges and controversies in American surgery. LD, my division and the Department of Surgery at large want to sincerely thank you for coming to San Diego. It was really fun to have you interacting with the fellows and with the research residents yesterday and touring the hospital and having dinner with us. So please welcome our visiting professor, LD Britt.
Well, let me first say that I'm a card-carrying fan of Dr. Crumba, and so all this for full disclosure. Let me also say that he has had an unbelievable legacy, but he was given a legacy too. He had Dr. Hort, and obviously before him, Dr. Shackford. This place is well known. A prophet is not honored in his own land. Her own land, but you. I hope they recognize what you've done, and I'm very pleased, and I'm sure your legacy will continue. Dr. Clare, I know you're new as chair, but I've always been impressed with what I've seen. You have a great department, and I have no doubt you'll take it to the next level. You've had some good predecessors, Dr. Orloff and Dr. Musa and the like, and so you seem like you're getting ready to set your own stage, your own chapter, and I wish you well. I have a great friend. I've had a lot of success, but I had good partners to help me. I would not have done well in the American College of Surgeons had it not been for Brent Eastman. And I haven't had a chance to formally thank him. I thanked him, you know, off the record. But in front of this audience, I want you to know, I had some battles, and I would not have won those battles had it not been for Brent Eastman. So I owe him a great debt, and I appreciate you coming. Now, having said that, I have a full talk, so I'm gonna get going. You know, you talk about the healthcare. It has been a long and unexpected journey in America. But I think we will all agree that if you look at the variables, the two fundamental variables, because everybody's worried about their health status, at least I hope you are, that can impact your health status is quality of and access to healthcare. Well, before the curtain goes up on healthcare, I want you to know we have had some challenges and we have some controversies. And we are not where we're supposed to be in healthcare. In fact, this is not me. And again, I want you to, so you don't get mad at me, I am not the male, I'm the mailman. And I'm just bringing what I have been able to discern during my leadership roles and working with Brent and others and Dr. Crumba. America's largest industry employs a sixth of the country's workforce as a healthcare industry. So this is major. It is the most dysfunctional industry. I don't care you read it, they will tell you that. Barely half of those who work in healthcare industries are actually healthcare providers. That's a problem right there. And the financial underpinnings, and that surprised me, of the healthcare system. That's why most people run to healthcare. Everybody wants to be in healthcare because that's where the money is. That system, that healthcare system is larger, the underpinnings of the healthcare system are larger than all France's entire economy. And if you look at the components of healthcare, we all know the components, but they're many. And they're increasing. I always like to lay the landscape. Let me tell you the landscape of the United States healthcare. We have a population of 315 million. If you want to know the denominator worldwide, it's 8 billion. We have about, and I know this as the commissioner for the Joint Commission, we have about 4,500 hospitals. We have a little over 800,000 active physicians. I'm not talking about those who are retired. We have 2.5 million active registered nurses. We have, obviously you see here, 1.5 million health aides, and then obviously we have our colleagues as respiratory therapists and the like. That's the landscape. But the major healthcare issues with that landscape, you see them up here. Workforce, cost of healthcare, insurance coverage, quality and disaster planning, all contributing to the healthcare disparities in this country. Let me just take a few. Let me take workforce. I think we all know there's a physician shortage, and everybody wants to live in San Diego. You all may not have a physician shortage here, but if you look across the country, I mean, everybody wants to live here. I tell you, with the weather, I wouldn't mind moving here, but I can't afford it. The population is growing, which adds even more of a burden. The elderly will double in the next decade. People are living longer with more chronic illnesses. Best prevention will likely not eliminate disease, only delay it. So all this is problematic with the backdrop of obviously not having enough providers. And then if you realize the population, this population increases 25 million every decade. That's a lot. And we have a new demographic. I agree with Atul Gawande. I don't agree with all the things he said, but I agree with that. It is a new demographic. The number of geriatricians have fallen, so we're going to have a problem because we're going to have older people. As you get older, you have comorbidities. I know that. I got to work out almost 20 minutes before, as soon as I get out of bed. You have comorbidities. And at the end of the day, we have a shortage in our discipline. And I would say most of you all are general surgeons or general surgeons enthusiasts. And we've had a precipitous decline in general surgery. And I call it general surgery specialty. A lot of people say, oh, you want to be just a general surgeon. It's not just a general surgeon. I'm a general surgery specialist who has an academic interest in acute care surgery. But we have a decline in that. And I will make an argument that that's just probably the specialty that most people should embrace. But let's get back to the workforce. It's maldistributed. If you look at globalization, the workforce is even, but I'm not going to go global quite yet. The aging of healthcare providers, you all are a very young group. I understand in San Diego, you all live long anyway, so I can understand that. We have ethnic and gender issues as far as the workforce, and we have a shortage that's overall of all providers. Let me talk about the costs. We are going bankrupt. Don't get me wrong, I'm big on technology. But I was recently in Philadelphia, and I could stand on a corner, take a rock and hit an institution that would have two robotics and turn around and hit another institution that would have two robotics. This technological revolution is tough. In fact, as I call it, the medical arms race. And the problem is, and this is what I don't know, and maybe, you know, I knew I was coming to a bright audience, so maybe you all can help me out here. In any other industry, as technology advances, the costs will go down. When I bought my first computer, it was $4,500. Now I can get a laptop, I can go to Walmart, not that I shop there now, and get a computer for a couple hundred dollars. But in healthcare, the more advanced the technology, the more expensive it is. And no one can explain that. And it's putting a weight on us. If you look at per capita, this sort of trajectory now, we're in 2017 now, it continues to go up. This is unsustainable. Now hear about what my business colleagues tell me. They said, don't worry about it. Market forces will control the healthcare industry. Let me tell you something. Market forces do not apply to curtailing the expenditures in healthcare. That's a great myth that people have. Market forces will never do that. So you depend on market forces, then obviously we're behind the eight ball, in which we are. And if you look down the road in a few years, we will be at $4.35 trillion. I'm not sure what the new administration is going to do. I have no idea. I don't think they're going to curtail the expenditures. It's tough to do for a lot of reasons. So that's where we are. And this is, again, I know people don't care, but let me just tell you. You know, my mother told me to always look at the budget. This in 2014, our federal government spent $3.5 trillion. Okay. I guess, so what's the big deal? Well, let me tell you why. $3 trillion was financed by us. By you, me, others, with tax revenue from income tax, payroll tax, corporate income tax, and then the rest we had to borrow. So as we get more in debt, it's going to impact us. Now remember, I'm not running for office, so I'm not political. Again, I'm just bringing you the facts. And a lot of people say about the burden, we cannot afford more debt. You look at your individual debt. I thought I would never see this slide before. I never thought that the student loans would eclipse credit card debt. But that's where we are now. In fact, here's a nice curve where you see how in 2010 and onward, the student loan burden is unbelievable. And so we cannot afford more debt, and we continue to do what we do, which is spend money in with the healthcare expenditures. Even the Congressional Budget Office has said that if medical costs continue to grow unabated, total spending on healthcare would eventually account for all, and let me emphasize again, all of the country's economic output. That is unacceptable. So again, you don't have to be a financial genius. We have a fiduciary responsibility to find some way to, I'm not talking about rationing, but some way to curtail the expenditures. So the overarching question is, okay, something I would say, okay, fine, you know, let's continue to spend. We get value. So what kind of value does the United States receive for all of its healthcare expenditures? Let's look at outcomes. This is recent. This is recent from the Harvard Council. This is where we rank. If you look at health and wellness, and that's all we think about is being well and healthy. In fact, as I tell people, your first wealth is your health. And so we're 68. Like I said, how can that happen? How can we have some, you know, look at Ethiopia and Cambodia, but what people don't realize, and this slide will startle you, the next one. People don't realize that if you look at premature death, everybody wants to live a long life. You look at premature death, what contributes to premature death, only 10% is healthcare. So even if we take care of this healthcare issue, we have all these other things part of the pie that we need to deal with, that we have a tendency not to even talk about, almost like the crazy uncle that you hide in the attic. And so you look at longevity as a measure of health, of course it is. And if you look at what we're spending, expectancy of United States citizens is the lowest of all the industrialized countries that spend a fraction of what we spend. And people say, why are you so adamant about that? Because this is something we're not getting our money's worth. We're going bankrupt. Somebody has to obviously call the show. This is from the Robert Wood John was on the advisory council, and I had a chance to access all that data. They have some great data. If you look at what we spend, we should have a life expectancy on this slide of 80.1 years. We're at 77.5, which means that we're not getting our money's worth. And if you look at people say, we don't have bipartisan agreement in Washington. Yes, we do. We have one issue, we do. The one issue bipartisan agreement, the number one pocketbook concern for voters of both parties is the out of control healthcare expenditures. We're all on the same page, all on the same page. Now, the good news, our bad news, is I'll tell you this, and I've said this before, and people get startled when I say it, more money will not solve the problem. We can put another $4 trillion in there, and we'll still have the same problem, because it's not a money problem. We have enough money in the system. It's not more money. We just have, obviously, we need to have another way of dealing with things. Let me give you some alarming facts. Because most people, we become sedated with the fact that, you know, I've heard this before, it's not a big deal. Let's go global. And I'm not going to go global much. A third of the world's population, remember, 8 billion, lives on less than $2 a day. I can't brush my teeth for less than $2 a day. And you have one continent, which is Africa, that only spends 1% of all the world healthcare expenditures. So you're talking about a maldistribution, that's problematic. There's a poor distribution of dollars. The United States spends over $2 trillion, as I told you before, and half of all the healthcare dollars spent in the world is spent by us. And we're ranked 68. And we don't have the life expectancy. If you look at the drivers of healthcare costs, these are the major drivers. High administrative costs. I have an administrator, and I mentioned this when I was at Scripps. Dr. Eastman invited me there to be a visiting professor. I enjoyed it. And I reported on this because I know he has some CEOs in the audience. I was not talking about them. I was talking about mine. My CEO has an 11 hospital consortium. It's not General Motors. It's not General Electric. He takes home $8 million a year. He can't even spell on call. And when I talk to him periodically, I say, you're over here. You're an expense. Good thing I don't work for him. Another driver of healthcare costs would be managing chronic illness and disease, which accounts for 80% of all the healthcare spending is dealing with the chronicity of diseases. And the major factors, obviously, for this, as you see, social environment, behavioral, those are the things we have to do. So our team has to be more than just healthcare providers if we're going to try to tackle this dilemma. And then as you see, the disparities in healthcare includes all these issues. And solving the problem of healthcare disparity will be the most difficult challenge facing this nation, but I'm encouraged because I think we have the intellect to do it. You know, my time is over. You know, I'm not in the clubhouse yet, but I'm on the back nine. But I do think we have young minds that will be able to figure this out because it's not going to be more money to do it. Now, let me talk about overutilization, some of the drivers of healthcare costs. Now, I knew I'm close to Hollywood, so I wanted to bring this slide. $17 billion annually is spent on artificial knees and hips. That's more than all of Hollywood took in for a year for the box office. And this is startling. If you look at the attempting to treat back pain, I'm not even talking about these, that's attempting to treat back pain, it's $86 billion a year. That equals the amount spent in the state, city, country, town, police forces combined. And in the average American family, the largest expense out of pocket are through taxes and insurance premiums. And then if you look at bank, I know no one gets bankrupt in San Diego, you all have so much money, but there are bankruptcies in other parts of the country. 60% of the 2014 bankruptcies filed in the United States resulted from medical bills. So you tell me this is not problematic, of course it is. Now, let me talk about underutilization. So what do you mean by underutilization? What a lot of people don't realize, we have a health literacy problem. I'm not talking about people not smart, so I'm not an elitist. But they're not literate when it comes to health issues. In fact, Institute of Medicine, which is named the National Academy of Medicine, 90 million adults have trouble understanding and acting on health information. And if you see here, the complex text must be simplified because what happens is, this is a study from RAND. RAND is the West Coast, that's at UCLA. Bob Brooks and those folks there. Americans receive about half the recommended medical care. That's essentially what I'm saying, because they have problems. They have problems with being able to translate. We don't do a good job of translating it. So irrespective of what we do, if we don't do something with health literacy, we're not going to be able to impact the population. For example, patient education. Only 8% knew the warning signs of glaucoma in that cohort of patients. Only 51% knew there was a link between diabetes and eye disease. Only 16% had ever heard of a condition of low vision. I hadn't heard of low vision, so I'm part of that 16%. So maybe I'm not literate. 50% of diabetic patients do not receive appropriate eye treatment. Those sort of health literacy problems, we need to bridge that gap if we're going to make an impact. And then obviously look at the economic gradient, what I call the delta, the gap. The top 20%, and they said a lot of the top 20% live in San Diego, but I don't believe that, controls 83% of the wealth. And poverty, you look at all the predictors, you can talk about race and all, but all the predictors, of the consistent predictors of poor health is user-based because of poverty. But the high, that's based on how wealthy you are. A high income group, that's based on wealth alone, that's not based on race or anything, based on income alone, lives 6.5 years longer than the lower income group. Now let me talk about quality, because that's again, Dr. Eastman knows how I feel about that. There is no quality without access. And so if you at the end of the day, I find this the most problematic, our standing when it comes to newborn death rates. Our infant mortality rate is embarrassing. And most of the reason is because of access. So I want to focus on safety and healthcare disparities, and I'll focus on a few things. This is a busy slide, but let me help you out. These are the top industrialized countries, in my opinion, Australia, Canada, Germany, New Zealand, United Kingdom, and United States. Now, if you can see here, you can see it, I'll help you out. Six is the lowest number you can have. If you look to your right, you see the United States is flanked with sixes and fives. And I guess it was the most problematic when I looked at safety. For safe care, we're ranked six. We don't have safe care. We don't talk about it. One of the things I found out when I became a commissioner of the Joint Commission, for those who don't know, I'm not sure you all, are you all accredited by the Joint Commission? Okay, I'm sure you all doing a great job, so I'm not here to credit you. They gave me orientation. I'm on the executive committee now, the Joint Commission. I guess they wanted to startle me. So they gave me orientation. They said there are over 4,000 NEVI events, surgical NEVI events, Dr. Britt, that we want you to know about. And I looked at this pie and they gave me a little bit more. They said, for example, this was years ago, a foreign object is left inside a patient 39 times per week in this country. Not in San Diego now, I'm not talking about you all. Wrong procedure, wrong site surgeries, 40 times per week in this country. And these NEVI events occur among patients between the ages of 40 and 49. I thought maybe because these are elderly surgeons, but the surgical group is the same age as the group is impacted. If you look at this slide, we have malleables being left. I don't know, unless you're Ray Charles, I don't see how you leave a malleable in the abdominal cavity. And so Mark Chasson and myself and others, we are really on a charge to have zero harm as a first step to achieving a safe medical community. And if you look at preventing wrong site, let me tell you what will happen. There's scheduling problems that the reason why you have the wrong site surgeries in the pre-op area, in the OR. In fact, if you look scheduling, you have incomplete data and verbal requests, lack of standardization. That's one of the reasons why we have wrong site surgery. When I say wrong site, I'm talking about wrong patient, wrong level, wrong organ. In the pre-op areas, they're missing documents, impartial patient ID. In the OR, sometimes you cover where you mark the drapes. All the things you think that we don't do. And they're still stunning me with my orientation in the Joint Commission. They have said, and again, this is not in San Diego because I'm sure you all do everything right here. If you have a 200-bed hospital, I don't care what you do, you can expect 358 falls per year with 117 injuries at a cost of $1.3 million. This is conservative. And if you have a 400-bed hospital, I know you all have a 350 to 400-bed hospital. I know no one falls here. But other places, you can predict 659 falls per year, 216 injuries, and $2.4 million in costs. And then you talk about what people said, the seminal event. You've heard of that. That's a patient safety event that reaches a patient and results in any of the following: death, permanent harm, all the things that you know, and is not related to the natural course. Well, what we found is that with this those sentinel events, we have obviously temporary injury, we even have associated death. And so I asked my colleagues, Anna McKee is like the number two person at the Joint Commission. She's a renal person by background, was at Penn, but she's our number two person at the Joint Commission. I asked her to give me some data. I said, how are these seminal events done? A lot of them are self-reported, but you have some that are not self-reported. In fact, you see 25% are not self-reported, reported by the patients and family or the media. Sometimes it's anonymous. And so as we looked at it, what I realized, and this is how they really stunned me when they presented this orientation, they said the most frequently reported seminal events you see on this slide, if you notice, three are related to our discipline. Unintended retention of foreign bodies, that I mentioned before, wrong site surgery, post-op complications. And then I said, well, tell me over the course of, and this was a few years ago, if you look 2012, 2013, 2014, and 2015, 16, you see it is still in the top 10 as far as similar events in our discipline. I'm not even talking about the other ones. Something that we have not made an impact. In fact, if you look at quality, you talk about quality, you have to talk about safety. And this slide startled me too, because to your left is very unsafe. To your right is ultra safe. So you're telling me, and this is actually good data, that the nuclear industry is more safe than the healthcare industry. And that's problematic. And that's where we are. And again, you can talk about all the shifting paradigms that people like to talk about when they give talks. But at the end of the day, the key underlying trends affecting optimal health care, this is listed. You notice they didn't include this, which I think is the most problematic, is safety. But for some reason, we're not talking about it. And so the Institute of Medicine, when they looked at their six aims, which is now the National Academy of Medicine, they had six aims of care. And we have problems with equitable. I'll get to that in a minute. But the one that we have the most problem with, in my opinion, outside of being equitable, is safety. You all remember the IOM report. I won't go through that. The error is human, all those sort of things. And we were all startled by this. Some were sedated by it. 44,000 to 98,000 deaths per year. This was back in the 90s. They came up with this. On average, two significant errors per day in each ICU. Now, I notice that no one grimaced. People that you're not, let me put it in context for you. Let me tell you what, let's take the low number. Let's take 44,000. Okay. 44,000 is like packing a 747 jet, which I'm going to fly out of, going to Chicago today. And that jet being packed, no seat available. Everybody's in their seat. And a jet like that crashing every 3 days for a year. That's 44,000. Now, I guess I got your attention then. I mean, if that happened, none of you all would be flying. You'd be like Aretha Franklin. You'll take a bus everywhere. But for some reason, this is not raising an alarm when it comes to healthcare. These are mistakes. Now, instead of getting better, and I hate to say this, and again, I love a tool, Gawande, and he has a checklist and our timeouts. Even with the timeouts and the checklist and all the things we do, not only has it not improved, we have 400,000 deaths per year based on medical errors now. That's our calculation there. And at the end of the day, now we are in the mode of trying to do defensive medicine. And let me just pivot for a minute, because I don't want to forget the public. The public is, because of all those things, because they read that too, they don't trust us. There's some mistrust, and some of it's historical. You know, the Tuskegee study, the Willowbrook study, where they gave viruses to retarded children. So we have a track record. I'm not saying they're outliers, but the public has a concern. So they're so frightened, they don't even come to us. They go to the lay press to find out what's the best hospital, who are the best physicians. And they know that the occult assassin, they realize the medical errors. And again, I had the Catherine Sebelius and Dr. Brent Eastman and I, we went up there to visit her. And I thought she was a good Secretary of the Health and Human Services, but I guess that everything is political. She spoke her mind. She said, if you were to give our nation a grade on health innovation, at best, I would say we would have an incomplete grade. And this is our leader of Health and Human Services. And you can see why. You look at scientific knowledge. Scientific knowledge, the last century, doubled every decade. They have already established that this century, scientific knowledge will triple each decade. We got some of the brightest minds in this in San Diego. This is a well-established department. I know the track record. But even the bright minds here, you cannot process that sort of information without some aid. And so we have to have some way to process it and implement it. Everybody talks about Six Sigma. Let me tell you something. We're so far removed from Six Sigma. How can you say that we are trying to practice Toyota Lean and Six Sigma? Six Sigma means out of a million transactions, you're supposed to make less than four mistakes. When I send a FedEx out, I don't worry about it because I know they make less than four mistakes per million transactions. How can we talk about Six Sigma when we're talking about two significant errors per day in each ICU? So we're deluding ourselves. If you look at a good industry, and I'm not a business person, but I guess I'm going to have to get used to it because our administration is all business now. A good industry, you have to know about consolidation, you have to know about cost effectiveness, and you have to have advanced information systems. For some reason, we have forgotten this part. If you look at information technology, these are the things that should be done. I know you're saying, look, I just started and it's not problematic. Let me tell you, it's not necessarily that we could have done better. Number one, if I had done this, we would unveil a monolithic electronic health record. Now you have obviously different all scripts and all that, and electronic health record not talking to another. But in a perfect world, it should work. The problem is we have superimposed a electronic health system on a dysfunctional discipline, and that's why we have the problems. And it should be reduced as far as errors. Man, let's look at utilization. That's utilization alone is problematic. You can't see this, but you have Sweden, you have Netherlands. The country that has some of the lowest utilization of electronic health record is in this country, in healthcare. Our business colleagues wonder when are we going to catch up as far as utilizing the technology that we already have and doing it the right way. In fact, even with people utilizing, we're beginning to see at the Joint Commission, sent on events, that's based on the electronic health record. I asked Dr. Castro to give me this data. If you look at here, we're seeing substantial sentinel events just based on poor management of the electronic health record. Let me give you an example. You have obviously and it's IT, but it uses the electronic health record. You have obviously medication errors based on just the health record, some mistake. You know how people are cutting and pasting. I remember I was sitting there the other day looking at my patient, looking at the consults. That patient turned from being a woman to a man, from being right side to the left side, because they were cutting and pasting. And that's problematic. In fact, if you look at the classification contributing to factors, uses a human-computer interface. Let me give you an example. You have clinicians not reviewing the test results, that patient's medical records, and there's no alerts prompting you to do something different. Not being able to have an alert for a critical result, things that are fixable. So we have a ways to go. And again, I agree with Gary Gottlieb. Gary Gottlieb is a Robert Wood Johnson scholar. He was the head of partners at the Brigham and Mass Journal, the partners group there. He said we can no longer afford a la carte medicine, and I agree with that. But also said that we no longer can tolerate unsafe medicine. And that's what we have now. We have to rethink the model, the age of accountability. At the end of the day, we need to maximize safety. And look at the best practice, because we have storms coming. And the reason why I said that, because if we're not improving and getting worse, That tells me we have more storms coming. There are a lot of threats facing us globally, and I'm not going to go through that, but the threat that's facing us that we can address will be the healthcare disparities. And for some reason, we're not doing that. And again, I look at the key things, and they include safety. I put safety there myself. At the top of the list, though, is healthcare disparities of the population. And I go back to the six aims. The one that's the most problematic for the IOM and National Academy, although I think safety is up there too, is having healthcare equitable. You all have the best healthcare. You're in the health system, you have a network. You lose your job, it's a whole different ball game there. And you look at the current perspective, I'm the most obviously distraught about is the widening healthcare disparities. And I mentioned about one continent responsible for 1% of the workforce. There's a malalignment globally. The malalignment you have here, there's 2,420 medical schools. I'm going to talk about some of the malalignment that makes this problematic globally. And you have 36 countries with no medical schools. You have 26 sub-Saharan African countries with no medical school. And you know how many medical schools we have. And we still have a problem with the healthcare system, even though we have that pipeline. You talk about a growing disparity. Most people think about disparity, they think about race. It's more than just race. Let me just say this. We know about some of the race. It's income, as I mentioned before. It is also a patient's income. A child is affected. Children in poor families are about 7 times as likely. I'm talking about children now. They are poor or fair health as compared to children in the highest income families. Education. And everybody in this room is educated. But let's say you're not educated, not finished high school. You're 4 times more likely to be in poor or fair health. That's a disparity. And that's where you live. And again, this is probably one of the best places in the world to live. But just based on where you live, if you live in Montgomery County, your life expectancy is over 10 years more than living in Phillips County, Arkansas, just based on where you live. And those are the disparities that we're dealing with. That's based on where you live. I'm not going to get into this. I'm not political, I'm not Democratic, I'm not Republican, I vote on issues, but I don't think anything divided us more than this. But let me just tell you the motivation. We needed to do something. As Dr. Eastman will tell you, the college, he was in a leadership role, we initially opposed the health reform bill, the Affordable Care Act, because it didn't address the SGR, it didn't address tort reform. But at the end of the day, we knew there was a rationale for it. You have 47 million or more uninsured, which I think will go up now with the appeal. But what got me when I looked at the data, 45, and this is not some sort of Hollywood trick, 45,000 people die each year from being uninsured. 45,000. So it's a real problem. There are solutions. We've been doing this. This has been a long road. A lot of people think it was just with President Obama, but Teddy Roosevelt started, Franklin Roosevelt tried to do something, Truman did, Lyndon Johnson did the best. Again, that's one of the reasons why he was crude now, But that's one of the reasons why I embrace him. And Dr. Eastman has a connection with the Johnson family. But at the end of the day, we needed to do something. In fact, Lyndon Johnson was the principal architect of the two largest federal programs designed to address the uninsured, which is Medicare and Medicaid, and we're still benefiting from that. In fact, the first person who signed up for it was Truman. That's who you see in this slide, Truman signed up for it. So I won't go through that, but at the end of the day, not having some reform was not a viable option, and it's still not a viable option. The facts are, you know, we pay the most, as I mentioned before. This gives us another ranking system, pushes us up a little bit 49th, but that's still problematic. And with the repeal, we're going to go back to about 50.7 million who are uninsured. And then obviously, I don't overlook some of the problems with ACA. It was new taxes. An employer had to spend $4,800 to $5,900. My state did not support it. They didn't go expansion, the Commonwealth of Virginia. I don't think North Carolina went expansion. So there's some problems with it. But at the end of the day, think about it. You look at the most valued brands in America, the most valued brands. And here are the most valued brands. You don't see one healthcare system up there. You don't see Kaiser. You don't see the San Diego healthcare system. You don't see my healthcare system, Centura. Why is that? You see Microsoft, you got Coca-Cola, IBM. These are the most valued brands. There's no reason for the most expensive industry not to have a valued brand on this slide, but that's not the case. And the reason why we have a healthcare system that's broken, that's the consistency. I know you say, well, I'm not sure it's broken. Well, it is broken if N equals the population. It's not broken if N equals San Diego, but it's broken if N equals the population. And it's unsafe. You know, Costa, Rebecca Costa, and I always like to talk about this book. I like the book, but it was very pessimistic. She said that we have lost as a nation the capacity to take care of big problems. Well, I disagree with that. She feels we can't. I feel like Einstein said, this is Einstein's quote, not mine, I think what we're doing is what Einstein said. We're using an old map to explore a new world. I think we need to see jobs in healthcare. Somebody who can think outside the box. And that's why I'm looking at some of the young people now. It's not going to be me. It's going to be you. If you look at it, I think we're in a renaissance period. I said that when I was at Scripps. I think, you know, we had one great renaissance. The renaissance period that went from the 14th century through the 17th century. Our country was founded during that renaissance period. I think we are now in a medical renaissance period, and that's why I'm not pessimistic. I just hope it doesn't take 3 or 4 centuries for us to come up to some solution. At the end of the day, again, I mentioned this, but let me just talk about healthcare disparities, because I think that's the pressing problem that we can address. It's multifaceted. There are a lot of things we can do. Dr. Eastman and I are on a committee of healthcare disparities for it's a regional committee. Looking at ways to try to look at targeted research to try to have an impact on all surgical specialties have some healthcare disparity. I would be remiss if I did not have a quote from Martin Luther King, seemingly that's on the back end of the holiday. He said that the arc of the moral universe, and this is in the Oval Office, this quote, the arc of the moral universe is long, but it bends towards justice. What he did not say is it doesn't bend by itself. It requires, obviously, the force. And what I have said, the arc of healthcare is equally long, but it bends towards optimal care and inclusion, but it does not bend by itself. It requires our involvement. Now, having said that, I want Dr. Long to come up, and I have a little video clip I want to show, and then I'll have a couple of slides, and I'm done. I'll finish on time.
My name is Edward Cornwell.
I'm Beth Sutton.
My name is Lisa Newman.
My name is Henri Ford.
My name is Ramana Husnain-Winia.
I'm Michael Zinner.
I'm Stephen Stain.
I'm David Hoyt. I'm the executive director of the American College of Surgeons, and I oversee the operations of the college and was helpful in trying to get this going initially by working with Dr. Britt. Dr. Britt, when he was president, in his presidential address, made the comment that you cannot have quality without access. And we were starting a campaign on quality that we'd then ran over the next 3 years. And when he made that comment, it just resonated, I think, with many of us that this was a fundamental problem that we needed to address.
We have a multi-trillion-dollar industry. There's no other multi-trillion-dollar industry in America. But we have the greatest healthcare disparities. of any industrialized country. That's unacceptable.
Before, in the literature, we always thought that it was mostly in the medical field, but never really thought that in surgery this would be an issue. And so it was a no-brainer for me to be, you know, interested in a collaboration to explore further surgical disparities in outcomes. We have assembled a really outstanding group leadership from the various federal agencies that we feel could really have an impact and provide some information which will be valuable for this research agenda.
It's often very hard to study and understand how do our systems work and lead to disparities, but how do we change the systems in demonstrable, evidence-based ways that actually reduce the disparities.
Over the last 2 days, we spent many, many hours trying to determine what are the most important issues that need to be studied to mitigate surgical disparities. And I'm very proud to say that I think we were very successful in doing this. We started in the morning on May 7th. We worked all day long, came up with nearly 400 or 500 different research questions that could be studied across 5 different themes. And this work was done by about 50 of the most preeminent surgeons and scientists from around the country. And they were aided by an army of staff, research assistants, and research fellows who helped get all of this process done. Those research ideas, they were all collated overnight. And the next day, there was great lively debate about what's the top thing to study and how to prioritize things. And the group did a great job and they stayed on task. They prioritized things top 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 for each of the different themes. And we now, I think, have a very formidable research agenda that both the National Institutes of Health and the National Institute of Minority Health and Disparity and the American College of Surgeons will be very proud of.
This has been incredible. This is historic to have such leaders, deans and vice presidents and professors of surgery and chair of surgeries in the various medical schools and hospitals.
I do think this is an exciting couple of days because you're bringing the entire research capability of the NIH along with the entire community of people that the American College of Surgeons brings together.
I'd like to come back to the ACS leadership and see if this is an initiative that we might want to do using multiple mechanisms. The R01 grant, a small grant, which is the R03, that allow us to look at some feasibility studies. And then I'd like to see us support maybe a U13, which is a conference grant that would represent a collaborative corporate agreement between ACS and NIH that would allow us to develop some additional high priority areas moving forward. Because I don't think this is something that we can get accomplished in 1, 3 to 5 years. I think it needs to be something that goes over time. So we need this conference grant mechanism or something in place that allows us to continue the dialogue.
In this nation in particular, we have the means to eliminate disparities if we put ourselves to it.
I hope this will be a template for other organizations to partner with the NIHs and maybe the CDCs and all of that. I want this to start a movement. I want this to be the beginning of a movement.
Let me say that, and thank you, Dr. DeLong. The good news is that we, Dr. Eastman on this committee with me, we were able to put in an all-one, and November the 4th was the deadline. We put in an all-one. I'm the principal investigator of that, looking at it's a multi-million dollar grant. We expect it to be funded and scored high and funded. And so we're going to tackle this. I felt that if the largest organization for surgeons in the world and the NIH can't partner and get some impact on healthcare disparities, no one can do it. And I'm convinced that we can do it. We'll have to do it, obviously, with steps, baby steps first. But this is our first step. And I want to thank Dr. Brent Eastman for his support. At the end of the day, and I'll close, because I want you all to have time for questions. I've noticed in my career, there's no shortage of celebrities, particularly as I'm on the West Coast. The shortest we have is with leaders. My take-home message is this one. And I'll leave with this. In the end, it's not what we don't know that will have the most impact on our health status, but rather the failure to respond appropriately to what we do know. We do know we have a problem. All the things I highlight, we know. We have a tendency to shy away from it, but we know that. So with that, Dr. Cromwell, I want to thank you for your invitation, and Dr. Clary, your hospitality. I always enjoy coming to San Diego. I just wish I could afford to live here. So I can't thank you all enough. And again, any questions, feel free. Thank you.